Hey, what's up, everybody? BDL44 coming at you another video. All right, so we're talking about the Golden State Warriors and the LA Lakers. Basically, they have opposite records. The Lakers are 30 and 34, and the Warriors are 34 and 30. And they're coming into this game 12:30 in the afternoon on a Sunday. You guys know me. I hate these type of games. Anytime there's a morning matinee. Matinee is morning, right? Yeah, matinee morning matchup. The Lakers are part of. It's usually going to be tough for the guys to get going. No D'Angelo Russell, no Bron, of course. And so we're going to be running with Dennis Schroeder, who's still trying to recover from that ankle injury. And even though he played fantastic through it that game, he came back the next game and was 3-for-13. Bunch of assists, but some bad plays. And with him having to chase around Steph Curry, who's going to be returning from a month-long injury, of course, he wanted to return against the Lakers, like everybody else does. And we knew that last time we played the Warriors. Last time we played the Warriors, they lost. And you know what? They haven't lost since. 5 straight wins. They've beat the likes of the Rockets, the Wolves, the New Orleans Pelicans, the Clippers, and some other team that skips my mind. But they've been beating all them teams. It was Portland. It was definitely Portland. And the thing about it is, in doing so, they've been rebounding the ball very, very well. And they've had some good help out of other players than just Jordan Poole and Klay Thompson. Jonathan Kuminga, of whom I told everybody was going to step forward now that they had traded away Wiseman, and you know, and of course Steph was out. I figured Kuminga was going to step forward, and he did. Played fantastic on both sides of the floor in the 5 games since we've seen them. And you got to give credit to Dante DiVincenzo as well, who stepped forward and has played fantastic in those games. Now, casual fans will tell you, Steph Curry returning to this lineup is definitely not a bad thing. What I'm going to tell you is Steph Curry returning to this lineup is definitely not a bad thing. This is the problem. Steph Curry is going to probably step into his shot just comfortably, even though he hasn't played in a month. I'd imagine he's going to be on minutes restriction, but because we're down guards, that doesn't help us that maybe he only plays 20 minutes. We're still at a disadvantage, even if he plays any at all, because of the fact that we're down our point guard. So this is the worst time to play the Golden State Warriors, in my opinion, unless Steph Curry comes in and overshoots and bricks a lot. That's really what can help us. Problem is the minutes restriction. Even if he does come in and do that, they're probably going to sit him down and then bring in Dante DiVincenzo and run stuff that they've been running for the past month very comfortably. So this is the same thing I said about the Minnesota Timberwolves. They're more so used to playing without their star than we were. So in any event, whether Steph Curry comes out there and decides to sit back down, or if he plays all 48 minutes, they're likely going to be able to run sets out there comfortably without him that should run the score up against us just because of the comfort level of what they've been doing without him. I don't think Andrew Wiggins is back yet. I didn't see the injury report. I tried to look for it for whatever reason. The links I clicked on just didn't have it available, and I just slipped away and started the video because I know this game is going to be starting up in an hour, and I know I could talk for a long time. So I figured it'd be best to not do too much homework on this game, but rather get this video out. So that's what I try to do, man. I try to speed rush through the homework. And what I came up with is just an understanding that the Golden State Warriors haven't lost since we've seen them. And when we did beat them, we did have D'Angelo out there. And if I'm not mistaken, I don't think Bron was gone either. I don't remember. But whatever the case may be, this is a different Golden State Warrior team. Klay Thompson is just getting in better and better shape, and he's been shooting a lot better since seeing us. And he had a pretty good game against us, if I remember correctly. So the Lakers are coming off of a game against the Minnesota Timberwolves where they lost the basketball game. And, you know, we had defenses come at us. That's what it was. They played fantastic defense with their players. Took advantage of some disadvantages that we had without our guys and with some lineup circumstances that we talked a lot about, and just ultimately put us in a position to be in a disadvantage from where we want to be. Everybody we needed to lose in the standings lost. And right now we're scrunched together with like 5 teams trying to find our way into the play-in playoff tournament or what have you. So, you know, when you look at a game like this, against a team that you know dang well is an NBA champion, got Steph Curry coming back, it's going to take everything you got to compete. in this basketball game. We're going to need our guys to really step forward and step up. Anthony Davis is expected to play. He's probable with his foot. You know, he played 38, had 38 points, did a lot of good things down the stretch of the basketball game, had the shoe issue. But that wasn't really what stood out for me. It was even further, you know, down the stretch of the game where he just didn't establish himself and get some shots off like I wanted to see him do as our superstar player down there. And, you know, I know he's used to deferring because Bron is usually out there taking over. But when he's not down there, I don't need him to be foreign to the understanding that he needs to step forward. And that's exactly what we saw there. And in dire circumstances, when we're basically fighting for our playoff lives, I just did not see enough of Anthony Davis down his final 3 minutes of the game. We didn't run enough sets for him throughout the course of the game. And I just think that a lot of what we're doing doesn't seem to align with the understanding of how urgent our circumstances is. We're about five, maybe even less, losses away from being completely eliminated from the playoff situation. It's only about 18 games left. And most of the teams that we have to play are teams that are in our conference that we're fighting in regards to. So we need to win these games, and dropping that Minnesota game was pretty disappointing, to say the least. So given the fact that we just lost to the Golden State Warriors, they're going to be highly motivated to beat us. You know, we just beat them, rather. So rather than to come in and assume that just because Steph Curry is out there, you're going to roll over and lose, you got to still have that urgency to say whether he's out there or not, we need to be ready to guard the perimeter and stop whoever's doing whatever. And that's really what it is. Or we can just roll over and lose and just be a, you know, be a team that offers another team like the Pelicans a chance at Wembanyama, because that's really what this is. You know what I mean? So for me, as a Laker fan, I'm irritated but not defeated. I feel like we have a good roster. We just have to have a different approach in regards to how we're using it. And you know, with the Lakers, we're always at a disadvantage, it feels like, as a fan. It, you know, in the start of the season, it was the roster. You know what I mean? And it just wasn't good enough. And last year, it was our philosophy with small ball. In our age, it just didn't allow for us to be very competitive most of the season. This year, now that we've made the trade, got some nice young players on the squad, everybody is ready to go. Now it's injuries and coaching rotation decisions that ultimately are an antagonist to our success. And so as a fan, it's just one of those situations where your hope today will be a new day. You hope Darvin Ham will correct what it is that ultimately isn't working down there. And so that's all you can really say. Today, I'm hopeful that we have done some things differently in regards to how we guard the perimeter. I thought Minnesota showed us that there are ways to guard the perimeter that we could kind of implement into what it is that we do with some of our talent, and maybe have more success against teams who are shooting so well, since we've had no success basically guarding the perimeter since we've made this trade, in my humble opinion. And given the fact that we're going up against a Golden State Warrior team that's known for that, and Steph Curry, who's probably going to launch about 12 threes or more, we need to try to understand that what we've been doing isn't working, and not allow ourselves to give ourselves any more excuses for not making those adjustments. So that's hopefully what we'll see, man. I'm very hopeful. I'm a Laker fan who spent most of the season disappointed and pessimistic about whether or not we would make a right move, whether it be a trade or no trade. They exceeded my expectations in making a trade that I wanted to see us make, which would give us multiple pieces that would give us length, a young shooter or two that could provide us plenty of that, and ultimately keep the players on the team that I really liked. We did most of that. I think the only player I would have loved to see us keep was Patrick Beverly. I mean, excuse me, not Pat, although I like Pat, not for us. Thomas Bryant, but Thomas had other things going on, and I think we upgraded with Mo Bamba. I'm happier with Mo. So it's one of those situations where I'm pleased with the roster. Now I just need my coach to, you know, sit down with the GM. Sit down with the GM. I want him to sit down with Rob Pelinka and get a better understanding of what Rob's intention was when putting this roster together, because I am almost positive Darvin isn't using it correctly. I'm almost positive. And if there's some disconnect in regards to why certain pieces are on the team or what it is that he's expected to do with those pieces, then that disconnect needs to be gone, man. They need to be able to use that roster in a way that works, and we need him to not get in the way of that. Everybody's and their grandmother is telling him that we need to adjust our power forward situation, and we need to adjust how we use our shooting guards. That is something that is costing us basketball games, in my humble opinion. So we got to see change there, man, or we will continue to lose. And that losing will lead us straight into a situation where we're just not good enough to make the playoffs. And even if we get into the play-in tournament, here's another thing that's very true. Even if you get into the play-in tournament, he's going to do this stuff in those games, and you will lose those games. So it's like we need to make some fundamental structural changes that make us a more intelligent defensive basketball team. Because we have the length, we have the talent, but the structure and how we're running, we're not getting the most out of ourselves, and we're leaning on the wrong things, and it's leading us to failure. So this Minnesota game should have taught us something. He's been really hearing it from all of us, and we need him to step up and show us that he can make the adjustments necessary to lean into success. Austin Reeves has been shooting very well. He didn't have his greatest game in the last game, and we benched him in the fourth quarter. But 3 games prior to that, the boy hadn't missed a single shot. We need to kind of lean in on his passing ability, because we're down so many playmakers. So not having him on the floor or Dennis Schroeder on the floor in any given moment is going to leave us without any playmaking whatsoever in this situation without D'Lo and Bron. I'm hopeful that our coach will understand that and not have us without those guys. I know he likes using Troy Brown. I like using Lonnie Walker now, too. Lonnie's been great, but not in the fourth quarter of the last game, unfortunately. So you gotta roll the dice. He likes using Malik Beasley. I like Malik Beasley. In fact, Malik Beasley has exceeded all of my expectations as it pertains to everything but shooting. You know, his shooting numbers hasn't been all that great in terms of behind the arc, but the intangibles that I didn't expect, those things have been good. Passing, defense. You know, he does a fantastic job of getting in passing lanes. He's quick to catch errant passes and stuff like that flies his way. He really helps us intangibly. Rebounds the ball where he can. I've been super happy with Malik Beasley. But the issue is when he can't hit shots, he's taking possessions away from his team. You know, when he's going 3 for 13 from behind the arc, that's 10 missed shots. Half of them we probably didn't rebound. So we just got to utilize him in a way that gets the most out of him and then walks away from his piece when it's time to move back into things that don't involve so much shooting. You know, lineups that don't necessarily need him to shoot 8 and 9 times, we need to not have him part of those lineups. Because at the end of the day, what he would be doing is taking away from possessions from guys who need to be shooting the ball in those situations. And if he's down there, he's only down to the shoot, really. So more Austin Reeves, please. More Max Christie. Max Christie comes in, strikes fast, rebounds the ball, and sits down. He is too intelligent of a player to not be utilized at all. You got to identify when somebody's smart. That's another thing that Darvin Ham is kind of not doing a good job of identifying. The intellect in a player like Max Christie, when he comes down there and immediately finds production in short amount of minutes. You know what I mean? Dude immediately comes in and finds himself a rebound. Immediately finds himself in a position to make a shot. He immediately comes in and strikes a jump shot. You got to understand when a guy is utilizing the ability to do a lot with very little and give him more. Since you play these guys that give you so little when you play them a lot. So that's the type of competence that I need to see developed within our coaching staff as a whole in order for us to find success. Because I see him leaning on guys that just don't do it for him. And I guess it's a personality thing. Maybe he likes these people or whatever. But I'm telling you, we need to be result-oriented if the Lakers are going to achieve this incredible feat, which is overcoming all the rest of the field who's fighting against us trying to get in the playoffs themselves. So this Minnesota game and all those different things that we did incorrectly put us closer to our season being over. And you can look to blame. You could blame the fact that we didn't get certain calls when we wanted to. And, you know, we can blame the fact that we don't have our players, D'Lo and Bron, the ankle and all that. You could get mad at all these different things that are relevant. But at the end of the day, we're just losing, man. I don't care why. We need to stop losing. And we've done a good job of winning games lately. I think we've won maybe, 3 out of our last 5 or something like that? 4 out of our last 6, something like that. But at the end of the day, we need to win more than we have in order to find ourselves where we want to be. We are in 12th or 13th place right now. You got New Orleans getting better with Zion coming back. Obviously, Steph now back today. You got, you know, KD's now played a couple games with the Suns. Well, he's going to be at the end of this day. He's going to have his second game against Kyrie and him in Dallas. That's a huge matchup. Obviously, them two. Phoenix. Sacramento is pushing forward. I mean, we just got to do what we got to do. Memphis is now, you know, they got that jaw issue. They lost Brandon Clark. So there's an opportunity there for somebody to slip up and take some free games. We need to be a part of that. We need to be a part of that. And so this is a game where I think we got to fight tooth and nail to win. I don't know that we're favored to win this at all, especially without D'Lo and Bron. But you got to find a way. You got to find a way or you're going to go away. That's really what it is, L.A. So I don't want to make any excuses for this bunch. I think they are a good enough team to do what it is that's in front of them. And I just want our coach to not be a deterrent to that success. Put the length on the floor necessary to defeat the players in front of you, man. Stop leaving them at a size disadvantage for the sake of speed. It does us nothing. I promise you it does us nothing. Give us more size and get away from three-guard lineups and we'll succeed. If you look at what happens when he puts those three-guard lineups on the floor and you look at that score, each and every time he does it all season long, look at the score. Somebody, please study that footage. Look at the score. It's going to go downward every damn time he does it. Do not put Lonnie Walker, Dennis Schroeder, and any other guards. Who is the third guard he would use? Probably God, my mind's gone blank. But the shooter, Beasley, Lonnie, and Dennis. He'll put them all down there. Slap Rui up there at the four, and then leave us with maybe Wenyen. You know what I'm saying? Or maybe AD. It doesn't work. AD's a four. Please understand this, coach. AD is a four. It's why he doesn't have any success against real centers. He can always rebound against anybody. It's the same thing I say about Bron playing the center. He could get his numbers from any position, but it's not about that. It's about from possession to possession when he's banging up against the people he's banging up against. Does he have success? And a lot of times you're asking AD to do too much when he's having to bang against real centers. To date, it's going to be Draymond Green, Kevon Looney, Jonathan Kuminga. Please use our centers. Please don't have him sitting next to Rui Hachimura trying to guard these guys, man. No. Put Wenyen, Vanderbilt, Bamba, and AD in rotation with the five and the four spots. Those are the only people that should be playing the four and the five on this basketball team, yo. Until Bron gets back, that's it. Rui Hachimura is a damn three, and if you play him at the four, you leave us without enough size at the five to help all of us when you keep them three-guard lineups down there. It does not work. And I promise you, if we see it today, you'll see it not work. And this is a thing that needs to be understood. It really doesn't matter if the other team is using guards or not, y'all. Because a lot of times people are like, well, the other team got guards on the floor. It doesn't matter because we don't function well that way, regardless of what the other team's matched up like. We do not function well that way. The urgency needs to be here, man. My voice is urgent because I have a very, very deep understanding of just how many games left the Lakers can afford to lose before this is all nothing. And it ain't many, y'all. It ain't many, and we got some really tough games ahead, including this one. You know what I mean? And so dropping that Minnesota Timberwolves game just made us significantly less capable of doing what it is we need to do because the teams that are in front of us are better than them. They're better than them in a lot of cases. So, you know, this is a do-or-die game, and I don't give a darn who cares, who plays or who doesn't. AD's supposed to be there. He needs to step up and give us everything he got, man. If you leave anything in the locker room and you don't leave it all on the floor, believe you me, man, you're going to regret it for the rest of the summer. That's just what it is. This is not the time to look up and say, well, we can afford to lose. No, you can't. If you go down by 30, you need to still be fighting because it's your season on the line here. It's your season on the line here. And at the end of the day, Steph Curry ain't played in a month. So if y'all don't have a better look at defending him, today, it's not going to get any easier if you have to face them in a play-in tournament or if you have to face them in the second round, first round. This is the easiest day you're ever going to guard Steph Curry because he's going to be fresh off injury. So I don't care what he's doing out there. His wind ain't going to be what it's going to be a month from now. So we need to have somebody on him, hound him, do whatever you got to do to make him feel as if he's 2 or 3 years older than he is. That's what we need to do tonight. Make Steph feel old. Klay's going to shoot. You got to be ready for that. Kuminga's going to try to get easy buckets. He's going to also steal and block shots. You got to be ready for that. He's really helping in the interior right now. Dante DiVincenzo, he's the one that's going to hurt the most from all of this. He's been playing fantastic. He didn't need Steph Curry to come back at all. But unfortunately, this is the Warriors. You play for the Warriors, buddy, so you got to go back down to the bench. But he's still going to do fantastic things off of that bench, so we got to be ready for him. Jordan Poole is one of the best players in the world. In my mind, I mean, just naturally gifted, blessed by God. He could do things that just most people cannot do shooting the basketball. And so even though he's still developing, I think they paid him a little too early. He is what he is. And as he continues to ascend, we're going to see that. I mean, he's just one of the best shooters ever, probably. So you just got to be ready for what it is he does. And he's going to play loose, but he hasn't been super efficient as of late. I think he was 3-for-10 from behind the arc in the previous matchup. So maybe we can get a little lucky and he doesn't hit shots again. But we know this is one of them dudes. So if he goes for 30, don't be surprised. They just got a nice team, man. You got to look out for Jamichael Green. He's a nice player playing off their bench. You know, they got a guy, who else? Some other dudes, man. I can't think of their names right now, but they're using him in rotation. You know, Moses Moody hasn't been playing as of late. So hopefully that continues. But they got their guard play. They definitely have players that you have to deal with, strong guys that they're leaning on who are now used to getting more minutes. So I think our best bet is with Steph coming back, you hope that he can kind of shuffle up the rotation to make it a little uncomfortable for their team. Maybe make it so that he's, overshooting some, sitting DiVincenzo more. That kind of thing can help in theory. But the reality is that's damn Steph Curry, man. That's Steph Curry. Nah, that's not, like I said, that's not real, man. Casuals and basketball minds alike will tell you this is not a good thing, him coming back at all. No, it's not good. Even a half of Steph Curry is a headache for us, especially without D'Angelo. So I'm curious to know if the Lakers are going to find themselves laying an egg. It's an afternoon game. Last time we had an afternoon game, we went down by 27. The only reason why we were able to come back is because Dallas had absolutely no interior defensive help for themselves. So that's not going to happen tonight. We ain't got no Bron. And we need Anthony Davis to step up and step out, man. We you know, he hit 2 threes in the last game. I think he hadn't hit 2 threes in 3 years. So that was amazing to see. We need him to continue to attempt three-point shots. Not too many, but as many shots as we've allowed other shooters, non-shooters to take, I don't know why the hell he hasn't upped his threes, man. I really don't. You know, it's one of those situations. I watched Russell Westbrook miss probably 40 threes this season. Anthony Davis only attempt like 5. What are we doing? What are we doing? So let him attempt his threes. He only shoots so poorly from behind the arc because he shoots one every 3 months. So let's get it together here. Also, you know, I want to say that Dennis Schroeder's been playing well in terms of fighting through that injury. I'm still very pleased with that, but we got to not lean on him so much. You know, just like I say about other players, you know, when they play well, you play them. When they don't play well, you sit them. He's one of those guys that our coach tends to lean on a little more than he should, and I wish he had that type of rope for a guy like Mo Bamba. I wish he had that type of rope for a guy like Wenyen Gabriel, who really do help us win when they're played, but rarely do they play. Coach gave them both a combined total of like 15 or 16 minutes in the last game against Rudy Gobert and Naz Reid. Like, that's just the type of stuff that just makes you pull your hair out. Like, you can't win that way, but you can win if you play those guys. So I think you should do that. Anyway, that's where my head is, man. I'm very sarcastic. I'm frustrated that Timberwolves lost still. It's lingering in my head. I don't like the lack of urgency. When I'm of the Mamba mentality. I'm from that. So when I look at this crap and I see guys not, you know, really giving me what I need down the stretch of basketball games and not necessarily giving it their all when the season's on the line, it just speaks to what guys actually think about what it is they're doing. And I don't like it, man. I want people in here who believe in what they're doing. I want people in here who are going to fight tooth and nail for what it is that they're doing for the team. Because I believe in the team in that degree, and I want the people who are part of it to believe in it too. And that's just not the real NBA we're in, man. We're in the NBA where it's about other stuff. And so as we still have this old mentality that we're fighting the Celtics for championships and trying to win basketball games, it just seems to me that winning is secondary, third dairy, and fourth dairy, if that's a way to say it. And so I salute Kobe, you know, at this Kobe minute right now. We always want to do that. He never cheated us out of those games. He never cheated us out of opportunities to win, and he never put winning second. Never put winning second. So that's what's most missed. It's just Kobe not putting winning second here in Lakerland. We want guys to put winning first. So that's what I hope to see these guys do today. You need to win, not only for your team, but for your individual careers. You want to be a part of something good and helping the Lakers come back into the playoff picture in this season. When the Sacramento Kings and the Boston Celtics and all these other teams that are rivals of ours are really good, this is not the year to miss the playoffs. Clippers are there. Sacks there. Phoenix there. Mavericks there. Portland's fighting with us. New Orleans fighting with us. All our ops. All our ops. Utah. All our ops are there. Are we going to be the team left out? I don't think so, man. As a Laker fan, I don't want to have no part to do with not being a part of these playoffs. So that's really what it's about, man. The Warriors in the way, just like everybody else. If they're better than us or worse than us, it don't matter. They got to lose. And that's really what the mentality should be. That's really what the mentality should be. You gotta pull, do whatever you got to do. Play more Austin Reeves. Play more Wenyen Gabriel. Do yourself that favor. Those are two of your better players that you do not use enough. Play them more, coach. You know what I mean? And let's win. As far as everything else is concerned, look, it's not about stats. Because you can look at the stats from the last five games of the Warriors. You know they've been rebounding the ball. They've been turning the ball over too. But it ain't about stats when they're getting back a dude that can go for 50. It ain't about stats no more. It's about feel. How are they going to approach this game? Is he going to be a focal point of what they do? And if so, are we ready to guard the perimeter with the three headed monster shooters that they got? If not, the game's not going our way. That's it. You got to guard Jordan Poole, Steph Curry, and Klay Thompson. And you got to stop them from hitting shots. So if you're going to drop coverage, they're going to drop 50 on you. That's how that goes. So I'm poised for the Lakers to make some changes, man. They got to. The playoff lives on the line. So the Golden State Warriors won the championship last year. With all due respect to them, they don't need another championship this year. They ain't even had that type of season, man. So let's let them understand. Let's look at that bench. You're going to see Ty Jerome and a bunch of dudes that ain't up to par. Let's just be real. They got some nice ones. They got about four bench players that's really up to par. But the majority of that bench are guys that our bench should beat. And that's exactly how I want them looking at them dudes, too. You look at the back of that bench. When any of them dudes come in, we need to flex. Don't let them sit Steph and Klay down for 5 minutes. Because if they do, that's when we need to attack whoever that is that they're putting in. If it's Jermichael Green, put AD on him. Put AD in a position to score on that man. Make him foul that man. And that's how I look at it. Because they're going to have advantages if we're not shooting the ball well. And I was looking at something that they were talking about, the over and under. That's not a conversation that I ever bring into the table, the betting and all. I don't know nothing about that. But what I did pay attention to is they felt that Malik Beasley was going to have an over 19 game tonight. So I thought that was important. If he can shoot well, I think he was 7 out of 12 in the last game against the Warriors. If he's having a good Warriors season, so to speak, where he's shooting the Warriors down, that can go a long way in helping us offset the shooting that they're going to be doing. So I think establishing him could be key, but him establishing himself as a bricker tonight could be fatal. So we need to find that sweet medium of not letting him overshoot. But if he's hot, got to let him shoot. So that is the thought, man. That's where my head is. You know, I want to see Vanderbilt continue to do what he's doing. Step up. Catch the rock when it comes your way. Continue to disrupt things. You know, that's what I want to say. He's so disruptive, man. You'll be sitting up there watching a smooth defensive play, and all of a sudden the ball's in your hands. How the hell do we get the ball? It's one of those type of things. It's like, weren't we just, like, smoothly playing defense? You see so much basketball that you know how possessions are normally going to go. He breaks in possessions in half. He just comes up with the ball sometimes. So keeping him on the floor and allowing him to do that makes life easy for everybody on the floor with him. He with the energy that he exerts, he makes it so that others don't have to exert so much energy. So when you put him next to energetic players like a Wenyen Gabriel, you know what I mean? Like an Austin Reeves, they're going to fly around. They're going to do things. So I just want the coach to understand that. I would like to see Austin Reeves, Max Christie on the floor together, since I know they're two of the smartest people we got. And then you put Vanderbilt in those lineups. You know what I'm saying? You make sure that Wenyen and Bamba get in those lineups with you. Let that be your bench. Let them, those nice players, be your bench. Have them in a nice rotation in your third quarter, in your fourth quarter. I mean, in your second quarter, in the meat and potatoes of your team, your game, so that when AD needs to be fresh, we have him fresh. That's what we need, especially down the stretch of these basketball games. This fight to get into playoffs can't deplete our energy or defeats the purpose. So we got to lean on these kids. We got to be successful in doing so. We got to use rotations that complement one another. Meaning if your guy's on the floor, don't have the person next to him be somebody you can't play with, man. So that's all I'm saying. And I'm telling you, if Darvin does what he's been doing, We're going to lose this game, and then we're going to have more things to say that are going to sound the same. And that's the problem, man. He's consistent, but the consistency is bringing us consistent losing. And that must end if the Lakers want to take this very, very short timeline seriously. So that is really all I have to say, man. That's really it. You know, stats be damned. The Golden State Warriors are getting Steph Curry back. That means guarding the perimeter is everything. Rebounding the ball is everything. Because this is one of the best rebounding teams in the game. Draymond, Kuminga, even DiVincenzo had 11 rebounds in the last basketball game. They crashed that. So be ready for that. And, you know, I really want to see Rui Hachimura in positions to succeed. He's a good basketball player. But like Lonnie Walker, if you put him in lineups where you ask him to do things that he cannot do, you're going to think he sucks because he's not going to do those things. This is the exact same thing. You put Lonnie at the four and you expect him to be able to keep up with four guard lineups. No, he's going to look terrible. And then you're going to want to sit him. And it ain't his fault. Same thing you're doing with Rui at the floor. You're putting him down there and he's too small to do it. Same exact problem. Different player, different size, same problem. Stop screwing with our four spot, and I promise you, Darvin, you'll win. You will win if you use the size that our GM gave you, bro. But if you continue to lean on this small ball, you know, guards league, this is just a guards league. That's yesterday's news, brother. That is yesterday's league. You look around, it's a forwards league, and you had better be ready with length to rebound, or they're going to push forward past you. Guard that. So that's what I got to say, man. Y'all better go out there and beat these Warriors. I don't care who down there. You better beat them. BDL 44. I thank you all for watching. I'm out.